On July 2nd, 1982, a 33-year-old man decided he wanted to gain a new perspective on life. So he went to the surplus store and he bought himself 45 weather balloons. He strapped himself into a lawn chair to which several of his friends now tied to now helium-filled weather balloons. And he took with him something to drink, a peanut butter sandwich, and a BB gun, figuring he could shoot the balloons one at a time when he was ready to land. His name was Larry Walters, and we remember him as the man who thought balloons would lift him 100 feet off the ground and ended up 11,000 feet over the ground in the Los Angeles International Airport traffic pattern. He was too frightened to shooting into balloons, and so he stayed airborne for more than 2 hours, forcing the airport to shut down for the entire afternoon. And when he was finally safely grounded and arrested, the reporters had three important questions for him. Were you scared? The answer, of course, being yes. Would you do it again? No. Why in the world did you do it? He thought for a second, looked right into the TV cameras and said, because you can't just sit there. It's a foolish thing to do, isn't it? Yet somehow, let's say something about who I am, I kind of understand his motivation. All of us are looking for something. We're looking for meaning. We're looking for purpose. We're looking for fame, something to be remembered by. All of us like to have something to celebrate. I mean, imagine what a hero he'd have been if it had worked out. It's interesting that when Paul writes to the Roman church, he wants to encourage them, and yet he spends the first four chapters of Romans talking about bad stuff, about how hard it is to be remembered, how hard it is to do the right thing, about how it's actually impossible for us to do the right thing and to connect with God on our own. And as we come into Romans chapter 5, we see him shift gears, as it were, and remind us what it is to celebrate. I mean, we celebrate accomplishments, don't we? Like the graduation last week, many of you were away from graduation, and we heard that Jaleesa did amazing, and that there's other students. I know Steve Sutton also graduated and did well, and there's a number of folks that had the chance to celebrate, right? We love to celebrate things. We love to celebrate marriages. We love to celebrate births. We love to celebrate victories. We celebrate when our favorite teams win, don't we, Bruce? We love to celebrate. And when we get to Romans chapter 5, we see Paul once again with the word therefore. What does it mean, folks that are in here all the time? When you see the word therefore, what are you supposed to say?
What's it there for?
Right. And we see Paul shift gears after four chapters of saying, folks, humanity, you're lost. Folks, you're in trouble. You cannot do it on your own. God has revealed himself in creation. You're without excuse, and yet you keep messing up. Paul has really come down hard on the Roman church. And on you and I. And yet he suddenly shifts gears to say, therefore, we can celebrate. We can have peace with God. And he gives us some reasons to celebrate. To begin with, he says, the reason we can celebrate, if you have your inserts, you want to fill those in, is because of the peace, grace, and hope we've been given. Therefore, verse 1, since we've been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have peace with God? We take that so for granted. Most of us just assume if we're a good person that we're okay with God, that he's okay with us. But Paul says, no. First reason to celebrate is because you are at peace with God through Jesus Christ. It was Mother Teresa, when talking about peace, she said it this way, if we have no peace, it is because we've forgotten that we belong to each other. We belong to one another and to God. But Paul doesn't stop with him. We have peace through God, with God through Jesus Christ. He says this, through him, we've also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. So we have access to grace, and we can look forward to the future. Now, when I say I hope something is going to happen, what does that usually mean? That means I think it might. That I'm optimistic about it would be a good thing, does it? But the truth is, when you read the scriptural word for hope, it actually means a different thing than what we hear. I hear hope, and it's like when my kids say, "Can we do this week?" And we say, "I hope so." That means there's room to wiggle away, that it might or might not happen. When you read the scriptural word hope, it means certainty. Okay? If you read the word hope in scripture, and when it's based on stuff from God, it's certainty. It's not this might happen, it's not this could happen, it's this will happen. Not some misty uncertainty, but confidence in the future. When I say that my grandmother, who knew and loved the Lord, has gone to be with Jesus, and I hope that I'll see her again someday, what I'm saying is I will see her again someday. When I go to be with Jesus myself, or when he returns. That's the promise we have. It's something to celebrate, my friends. That we have this confidence, this certainty, and that we get to rejoice even in our suffering. Look what he says in verse 3 to 5. More than that, already the reason we have celebration, we have peace with God. More than that, we rejoice in our suffering. Knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. We rejoice in our suffering. Why? Because, as Jesus put it in John chapter 16, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And I read that big word tribulation and I always thought, what does that mean exactly? You hear people talk about end time and all that stuff. Tribulation simply means pressure. In this world, you'll have pressure. There'll be things pressing down on you sometimes. There'll be things pressing against you at times. There'll be things pressing up from below at times. You know, pressure comes at us from every direction. And the promise is a simple one. God will not waste the pressure that you are feeling. He will not waste your hurt. He will not just let it happen to you and then say, there, you made it through. He uses it to develop something in us. Endurance, character, and hope. And the Holy Spirit is at work in all of it. God's love being poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit he has given to us. We can celebrate the peace, grace, and hope we have. We can celebrate because God's love has no limit. Isn't it an interesting thing? Our love is so often limited, isn't it? When I think about who I love and who I'm willing to love, and generally, if I meet a nice person, I think, okay, I like them. I want to be their friend, and eventually I may be willing to love them. But what do I think when I see somebody who's really mean or nasty or just cranky? Right? I had a conversation with somebody yesterday that I walked away thinking, boy, I don't want to see them again soon. Can I be that honest as your pastor to admit that I don't love everybody equally? I'm human. You're human. You know what I'm talking about. This idea of limitless love is something we have a hard time even wrapping our mind around. And yet we hear that God's love has no limit. Look at verse 6. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Jesus Christ was willing to die for the weak, for the ungodly, for the sinner. Weak as in helpless. I mean, I'm a pretty physically strong guy. Most of you are fairly physically healthy. You don't feel like you're weak, right? But as in helpless to change your situation. A little while back, my new son-in-law's sister decided to run away. She's 16 years old. She decided she had enough family at home. So what'd she do? She just disappears. She takes the family car, leaves a note, by the way. If you're ever running away, kids, here's a note lesson for you. Leave a note. She leaves a note saying, I'll bring the car, get the car back to you, but I'm not living here anymore. And that's all it said. Right? The definition of helpless is what her parents felt at that moment. They didn't know where she was. They couldn't find her. They didn't know what to do. Helpless. And so when Scripture says, when they were weak, Christ died for us, that's the idea. Helpless, unable to do anything about the situation. That's where you and I were. When God first showed us love. We were unable to change our situation. And then ungodly, that word has been abused. We say ungodly, we usually mean wicked, evil, bad people. But let's go back to English lesson 101. What does un mean? Not godly. They don't have God. God is not in their life. Okay? So, Christ died for the people like you and me. The ones that couldn't change their situation and that didn't have Him in their lives. That's what He died for. For regular people. God's love has no limit. You look at verse 7 and 8. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. Like the guys that bodyguard the president, right? That supposedly will take a bullet for him because they think he's a good person. I say supposedly because we haven't seen it, have we? Except in the movies. But the idea there is that sometimes for a good person you might be willing to take a chance. And for somebody you love, you might be willing to sacrifice yourself, right? But in general, we're going to take care of me first, aren't we? Well, look what He does. God shows His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. We have a reason to celebrate. While we were weak, while we were helpless, while we were ungodly, far from God, while we were still disobeying Him every single day of our lives, Christ died for us. Friends, we have a reason to celebrate. Look what He did for us. He gave us peace, grace, and hope, and He showed us that His love has no limit. He sacrificed His own Son so that we could live. So that we could have life. There's a reason to celebrate. And that's that life is much more. Look how He goes on. In verse 9. He says, since therefore, there is the end, we have now been justified by blood, much more shall we be saved by Him from the wrath of God. Ooh, I don't like that verse. I don't like the idea that God was angry with me. When I think about God being all-powerful, what He could do to me, when I think about Him knowing everything, what He could do for me, to me, when I think about Him being all-present, as in I can never escape from Him, He's always there, so every time I think I got away with it, guess what, folks? We didn't. And it tells us that we were enemies of God, that He was angry with us. A man named Jonathan Edwards, back in the 1700s, a preacher, preached an amazing sermon called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And he quoted John 3, verse 18. We always stop at John 3, verse 16. Have you noticed that? Two verses later, this is what the scripture says. Whoever believes in Him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. Not believing is disobeying. Not believing leaves us condemned. And the Bible says it's not enough to be a good person. I know a lot of good people. I'm sure you do too. People that are generous, that are hardworking, that take care of their families, but they don't believe in God. They haven't accepted the name of Jesus Christ. In Acts 4, verse 12, it says, there's salvation in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Friends, we have a reason to celebrate. We have been set free from God's anger. He's taken away His judgment on us. And much more, verse 10. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by His life. Friends, God reconciled Himself to us through Jesus Christ. And it saves us from a meaningless life. Jesus didn't just die on the cross, pay the price for our sin, and stay there, did He? The tomb is what? Empty. He rose again. We have a reason to celebrate. We get to party. Imagine if we party at graduation, if we party at marriage, if we party at births, how much more would you party at resurrection? Yeah. Amen? How much more would we celebrate if we've been there that day and got to see our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ stand up, walk out of that cave and say, hi, I'm back. I mean, He said it before Arnold did. I'll be back. We have a reason to celebrate, don't we? If you know Jesus Christ, if you took on your faith and trust in His name, He will save you and give you life. Much more than that, He'll show you the way to live. And what to live for. Give you a little more meaning and purpose than that Larry Walters guy floating around in the sky over LAX. We have a reason to celebrate, my friends, the reconciliation that we're given. Reconciliation is a big fancy word, but it just means forgiveness and a restoration of relationship. When I was a teenager, some of you heard the story before that my mother had an ashtray in her car that she threw all her loonies in. And week after week, when she had a little bit of change, that's where the loonies went. That was her savings bank, apparently. But I wasn't thinking about that. I was just thinking about the fact that one loonie equaled four video games at the arcade. Some of you know where I'm from. And I noticed that ashtray was getting really full. I thought, she hasn't counted those. She's just tossing them in there. God, she won't miss a couple. And sure enough, I took a couple, and I went to the arcade, and I had a bunch of video games, and she didn't miss them. Now, this is good. Because I didn't have an allowance or a job. I was a kid, right? So, you know, this was how, you know. So I took a couple more. And it was a great system, because every week she'd add a few more, and every week I'd take a few. This was good. What, for probably a month. But then inevitably, she noticed that the thing wasn't overflowing. And she hadn't taken any out. And it's an ashtray. It's not a bottomless pit. So she confronts us kids, and sure enough, I sneak it. My heart's already down here, and they can see what I'm thinking, just look at my eyes, and she goes, it was you. Now, why the poor kids looks at me, she knows who's guilty. What does that tell you? I had broken trust with my mother. I had stolen from my mother. I even tried to deny it when she first said it was you. I said, no, it wasn't. She's like, yeah, right, you know. I can't hide that stuff. Reconciliation is this. As a kid with no job, no allowance, no way to earn that money back, the first thing my mother did after she judged me is she said, this will be your punishment. But then she said, I forgive you. She didn't say you're going to have to pay me back, because she knew I couldn't. I was helpless to pay her back. She forgave the debt in its entirety. First of all, because she had no idea how big the debt was. She just knew I'd been taking stuff. Because she hadn't counted. But secondly, because she knew I just couldn't repay it. So she forgave the debt. But then she did something really amazing, folks. She started to rebuild our relationship. She still spent time with me. She still treated me like her son. She still wanted to go out and go on bike rides together and to spend time talking with me. And so today I can stand before you saying I'm reconciled with my mother who I stole from because she forgave me and she restored the relationship. She was willing to trust me again. And there's no time today when my mom would go, remember that time you stole from me? I still don't trust you. It's a long time to come out. But she doesn't do that. That's what reconciliation is all about, friends. Is God doesn't just save us and say, okay, now you're not judged, now you're not going to hell, now you're free from punishment. God says, I save you for life with me, with fellowship and relationship with me. We have something to celebrate. Look at verse 11. Paul has already said twice, much more, much more. Look how he begins verse 11. More than that. He saved the best for last. More than that. We also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through whom we have now, get this, received reconciliation. Remember we were weak and ungodly? He gave this to us like he gave us his son. He didn't just say, I'm going to cover the punishment because I don't want you to go and burn in hell forever. He said, I want to be in a relationship with you. I want you to know my love is without limit. I want you to know much more. I want you to have peace and grace and hope. I want to be reconciled with you. We have something to celebrate. Funny thing, how easy it is for us to sit there and friends, I spent 10 years in the pew as a lay person before I became pastor, and I know that you come to church with all your burdens and all your struggles and just the busyness of life and the things you've been thinking about, the things you've been watching, the things you've been reading, the pressures, the tribulations. And we sit on Sundays and we sing Amazing Grace and we sing How Great Thou Art and we hear about how amazing God is and we go, yeah. I've never in my life felt fell asleep at a party. I've never fell asleep at a celebration. We have something to celebrate. We get to rejoice. That's the word that Paul uses throughout this passage, rejoice. We rejoice in God because He's our advocate. We rejoice in God because He's the Almighty One. He is the author of life. He is the chief shepherd, the creator, the counselor, the deliverer, the everlasting Father, the faithful and true One. He is our guide, the Holy One. He is the source of our hope, the perfect judge. He's the King Eternal, the Lawgiver, and the Light of the world, the Lord God Almighty. He is love. He is merciful. He is our peace. He purifies us because He's the Righteous One. He's the rock and the source of our strength. He is the teacher. He is the way and the truth and the life. We have something to celebrate. Flying a lawn chair sounds pretty foolish to us, doesn't it? The idea of strapping a bunch of balloons to a chair, grabbing a peanut butter sandwich and a Coke, and going for a fly just doesn't even compute with most of us, does it? And yet, how many people try to live life without Jesus? God sent His Son to be the way, the truth, and the life, to reconcile us to Himself. So what will you celebrate with your life? I invite you to come to the table this morning as we remember God's gift of Jesus' death and life, to renew your faith in Him, to join me as we celebrate that we have peace with God. If you haven't yet put your faith in Jesus Christ, if you haven't taken that step to really commit your life to Him, now is the time. It's foolish to do otherwise. If you have put your faith in Him, renew it as we come and remember His gift of peace with God. Would you pray with me?